We'll talk about business and stuff first, and then we'll see how we go.
Yeah.
So,
how are you anyway, man? How's it going?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm going through a transition at the moment. I move into Newport, as you might have noticed. You've seen stuff I've posted. I don't know what I'm going to do yet, but I'm going to get involved with Alex and James, and they're doing their property collaboration groups, and they're like renovating houses and stuff.
Yeah.
It's early days. I'm going to speak to Alex tomorrow, and she's going to sort of, you know, give me some strategy and tell me what the situation is. And so, yeah. So I'm going to make a fresh start in South Wales.
Cool.
Yeah.
Where you go? Have you got a house? Do you know where you're going?
Well, yeah. I know where I'm going to be living. Yeah, I'm renting a room in a nice house. It's called Rogerstone. Do you know that area?
Yeah. Of course I do. Yeah.
So which part
of Wales?
Where
I grew up.
Oh, really?
Well, I grew up in Cwmbran, but used to go out with a girl from Rogerstone. So,
all right.
Yeah, they've got a great brewery there now, a great craft brewery there, just down the road. And cool. Yeah, I've seen Alex a bit recently as well. We had a bit of a gap, but it's like bringing the band back together.
It does feel like that a little bit. James was saying the same thing. Do you know what? I don't know what I've been doing. You're in Germany right now, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know what I've been doing for the last, like, 8 years. I feel like I...
You know, everybody else knows what you've been doing because you talk about it every day.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, I was reminiscing with James the other day. You know, we all met going to Yes Group and like the Tony Robbins events and networking events and all that kind of thing. Yeah. And then somewhere along the line, I went down the conspirosphere. I went down the conspiro hole, or if you know what I mean. And got into some kind of political activism stuff, and then started doing handstands and going to yoga. And I feel like I've only just woken up out of like an 8 year period of completely wasting my time. So I feel like I've just got back on the, what do you call it, back on the wagon or something like that, you know?
Yeah. What happened with the handstand thing? That looked cool to me.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm still doing that, to be honest. Yeah. I run workshops and I teach handstands all around the country, and I enjoy doing that. And I do the hen parties, and they're kind of my bread and butter. They just tick along and they don't take any hassle, and you know, I enjoy it. So yeah, I'll carry on doing that. But what I found was, because a lot of the activities I've been doing are like fitness and body orientated. I was doing a lot of yoga, a lot of dance classes, a lot of gymnastics, you know, a lot of that kind of thing. And I got to a point where my brain wasn't being stimulated enough, you know, and I was getting really frustrated. And so that's what that's kind of what made me want to you know, make a fresh start and embark on some new business projects again, just to get my brain in gear, you know.
Yeah cool. It sounds exciting. It reminds me of when I came to Germany. I think that was a fresh start for me. I think it's nice to take a pause and you invent yourself sometimes. You're good at that, though. You've done that a few times, I think.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it is nice to... Because otherwise, if something's not quite right and you just let it sort of drag on, it can just drag on forever, can't it? It's really good to kind of, well, you know, like be decisive, isn't it? Or sort of... And figure out what needs changing and change it.
But also, I think most people are scared of doing that. Like, I meet so many people who hate what they do and are scared of making a change. And that's what I like about you, who you kind of just throw yourself into whatever's in front of you at the moment, it seems. I don't know what's going on inside your head, but it seems like whatever's in front of you is whatever excites you enough to just throw yourself into it. And when you've had enough, you move on. And I like that. I think that's,
I think it kind of works. It is something I like about myself. I'm quite intuitive in the sense of I really pay attention to what is exciting me, and I try and follow that that track.
Yeah.
And I think that generally seems to be a good way to go, you know. But
I think that sounds good. I think I like it. So just, what do you want to talk about? Because, yeah, we could talk about anything. I don't know what, yeah.
Catch me up. I mean, wait a second. I'm just going to close the door. One moment. So, it's been a long time since we've spoken. I know you do business stuff, but I don't know a lot of detail about what you do. And so I'm interested to hear about your business stuff.
All right. So right now I have a incubator stroke accelerator business. So it's called Incubate with a Q, no QU, just Incubate. And I got to it because I was tired of, I was a business coach for many years and also doing some other things alongside business coaching. But the main thing about business coaching was it was great. I had some brilliant relationships, met some great people, and still work with a lot of those people today. But the challenge with it was, as soon as I stopped, there was nothing there. There was, you know, it was an hourly rate kind of, I mean, it wasn't directly an hourly rate, but you understand what I mean. As soon as I stopped doing it, there was no asset to sell apart from the work I'd done. And I always, the reason I decided to get into business coaching in the first place and the thing that drew me to it was because it was, I was seeing it as like a sort of an apprenticeship to doing some stuff by myself. And I did a few things by myself, and some of them went well, some of them didn't go so well. And when I came to Germany, maybe even a couple of years after I got here, I decided to sit down and figure out what I actually liked doing about all the projects, all the things I've been involved with. And I made a business out of it. And the model I went for, I sort of took a few things from different places. And it was that I was going to get involved with some businesses, take some ownership in some businesses, either by buying in or exchanging some time for some money, and do the parts of the business, running the business and building it, that I liked. And rather than sort of putting all my, trying to build my one single business and do and get involved in things that I, to trying to do things that I wasn't so good at, let the partners I was involved with do those things and stick to the things that I liked. So that's what we Incubate is doing. Officially we started, we started 2 years ago, but officially we sort of really got started with that in January this year. And what have we got? We've got five businesses now. And they're all at various stages. And so you've got me doing the strategy and the sort of the direction and the creating the sort of the plan and the framework for the business, and then building a team to grow each of those businesses. And some of those people work in my business and we share some of their time between the businesses that we invest in. And some of them, we don't do any work, but I just do the consulting and the sort of the strategic work with the people we're involved with. So it's kind of like business coaching before, but it's more directly involved and hands on. And I just got so tired of the coaching thing. So that's basically what we do. We've got businesses from fashion. We've got a brewery. We've got an app, a marketing app. We've got a photography business that's starting now with us. Really, really interesting business. An e-commerce business that's going great guns. And it's, really good. Having fun.
That's... And how does it work? Do people approach you, or do you approach the businesses, or can it be either?
That's really interesting. So since I've decided to stop being a business coach and start doing this, we've been basically fully booked. It's kind of the same work. It's similar work. But what I found is, because I'm so clear about what it is that I bring and what it is that we will and won't do, it's easier for people to understand and sort of commit to. And since then, we've basically got a waiting list of people that want to start with us. I don't really call it a waiting list. That's not fair. It's not like people are ringing me every day to come and start. But people are coming to us basically at the moment.
Wow. So essentially, it's like similar things to what you were doing with the coaching, but now you're going into partnership with people. Is that?
Yeah, basically, yeah. When I started, I had a couple of businesses on the side of business coaching. And one of the biggest frustrations I always had was when I need some help with marketing, for example. Maybe I would want some more leads. And I would talk to some marketing professionals or they had a marketing agency. And it always ended up being that they would want to charge a lot of money at the beginning and then hopefully they would deliver some results, but would never promise anything. And some of those people I started to work with, and some of them, I'm not saying they didn't do their best, but when the results didn't come through, they still wanted paying. And I always thought that didn't make sense. I thought that if it doesn't work that way in any other part of the world, you know, if I walk into a coffee shop and pay for a coffee, I expect a coffee. And I just thought that there must be a better way to do it. So I didn't want to start a marketing agency because I felt that we would end up in that same place where we expected paying no matter what. And so I wanted more control over the product. And, you know, if you're going to market and help a business grow and you're just responsible for the marketing, but you have no control over the product and how it's delivered, then you're kind of stuck. If they do a shit job at whatever they do, then it's really difficult to have any proper influence over the marketing. Mm. So I like this model, and it's not something I want to have 100 customers, 100 businesses in. I'm picking very carefully, and we're sort of focusing on the ones that we really like until they're sort of ready to be incubated. That's why we call it incubate, because the idea is that we build it into some sort of system that can then grow and run by itself. We properly started in January. One of them is, I think, almost ready for that now, which is really cool. It's good.
That's fantastic. I get the impression that you really enjoy the problem solving of, like, you know, there's a business model in front of you. It needs improving. And I get the sense that you enjoy that, right?
I was thinking about this when you said, come on, I thought Ben's going to ask me what I do. And I thought, over the years, I've thought it's marketing, it's strategic stuff, but actually it's just problem solving. I think that's the thing I like doing the most. If someone comes to me with a problem, that's probably why I like coaching, is that they've got, yeah, I just like to sit with people and solve a problem. Yeah, that's really good. Yeah.
I don't know if this is going to sound weird, but I'm one of those people who actually enjoys doing the dishes, because there's something about, like, cleaning the plates and then they're clean and they're done. There's like a satisfaction to me in that. I quite enjoy it. And especially if, like, there's something really needs scrubbing and getting off it, and then there's like a satisfaction. Like at dinner parties, I always wash up. I don't care for cooking particularly, but I like washing up. And I wonder if there's something similar about that. It's almost like taking a business that perhaps is a bit of a mess or needs fixing or improving, and like doing it up, kind of.
It's changed over the years. I think through one of the things, so we got together first at this Yes Group and the Tony Robbins scene and all of that lot. And I think one of the, and through the franchise I was part of with the business coaching, one of the great things is you learn so much and you get inspired by people who have done great things. And I know a lot of people who've done very, very well, and I used to take a lot of what they said as the only path, you know, as this is, they did that, they said this, so this is what I've got to do. Mm. And like you said, doing the dishes is something that you shouldn't do. You should pay someone else to do that. And look at that. And I've realized that it doesn't really matter. There's more than one way to skin a cat. And yeah, I like doing those sorts of things. I do like getting into the details of solving those problems. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
What are the key things that have to be in place in order for you to consider partnering with someone? Like, what are the deal breakers? Like, what are the factors or the key metrics or whatever you call it?
I've just got off a 2-hour call with someone who's going to start with us talking about this. So it's good that you ask. So are you talking about the person or the business? Because I've got some rules about the businesses I want to get involved with, and they're just personal to me about the things I like and the things I don't like and the things I'm looking for. Or are you talking more about the person and the people I'm partnering with?
Yeah, perhaps the person. Like, what would make you say, fuck that, I'm not getting involved with that? Like, give me an example.
Someone who's wants me to do the work. And I don't mean that I'm afraid of work. I'm working harder now than I've ever worked. But I know that if I have to talk to a customer to make a deal happen, that's in the complete out. So if someone's shit at actually doing the business that they do, I don't understand it. They've got an idea. So that's the first one. I've had a few people like that who've got ideas, and they might have a couple came to me. An artist came to us in the summer, and they had a really cool idea. It was just a sketch on a piece of paper of an idea. And they were good at the art, but they didn't know how to get the customer. They didn't know how to do the deals. They didn't know how to build a website. They didn't know, you know, and all that. They need to have actually done something and produced something, I think, is the first thing. Mm. And I suppose, that's a good question. I'm not sure what else. Ask me some more questions. I can give you some more details.
I would imagine that scalability is an important factor, isn't there? There must be some kind of businesses where there's a kind of upper limit to what can be produced. Is that something that you look for?
Yeah, but so that's the person aside. I'm assuming they're a nice person and I like them, and they're, you know, we're getting on, and they've actually created something. Business wise, I'm looking for things that are repeat business is the first one, because I wrote a document about a year ago when we sort of set up Incubate, and the rules that we wrote in it, I could find them on my computer actually, but from memory, one of the rules was we invest in boat cleaning businesses, not boat sales businesses, because you can only sell a boat once, but you can clean it every week. And I think that's important, because it takes a lot of work to get a customer. And although you might not make as much money when you clean the boat once, if you do a good job, and quite frankly, this is the thing that pisses me off most of the time, most businesses are really run poorly. Like, if you look at the average everyday businesses we use, just the corner shop or a hairdresser's or a car garage, they do such a bad job. You don't have to really be a genius to just do a good job. And if you want to make a great job, you just have to put a 5% more effort in and thought. And those are the ones I like, because once you build them and you've got those customers, if it's something that's needed, they'll just keep coming back forever and ever. And I think that's, for me, that's building an asset. Someone could buy that from me and get and earn from it for a long time. But a boat sales business, I mean, what? There's nothing, there's no asset there, is there, really? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. Yeah, it does make sense, because it's with a sales thing, it's more down to the individual talent of the salespeople, I guess, as opposed to like a system that just sort of...
Yeah, and if you've got some great salespeople, you do great. And if they leave, then what have you got? You don't really have much left. So it's so that's really important, is to find something that's got repeat business. I like things. The things that we like are things that we can improve. The things that everyone buys today, but we can improve them with technology. So with a better website or more automation or something that's going to make it easy for us to do more work than the competition with less effort.
Oh, I see. So you can increase the efficiency of what's by using more efficient systems. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, or perhaps more importantly, we can improve the experience of the customer experience. So Uber, for example, was a user interface, a technology user interface innovation. The taxi service is still the same thing, essentially. But the way the improvement is in how it's now much easier to use, because they gave you a button to press and the driver turns up.
Oh, I see. So you look for something where there's scope for like innovating and in that kind of way.
That's another good thing.
Do you run into the kind of situation where you've got a business, but it's very much dependent on, you know, like the business owner, and like without them, they're just the linchpin? And like, what is that a kind of situation that you would turn down?
I mean, as a business coach, that was what we did all the time. That was basically the market that I served as a business coach, where someone was a good hairdresser or a mechanic or a whatever they did, and they had a bit, they ended up with a business that did it, and it was trying to get them to a point where their team did that. But I think there's so many of those. I mean, I'm not really looking at growing in, I'm not looking for more businesses in this. So when you say when you're looking for this, it's hard for me to answer because I'm not really looking. I just wait till something comes along and I sort of try to find.
I see.
Yeah.
Oh, so it is dependent on a case by case basis. It's not necessarily a strict set of criteria.
Nah, I mean, there are some rules. Those are some of the rules. I think it's the problem solving thing. Like the brewery is a really good example. So craft brewery in town, local guy, friend of mine for a few years. And so craft brewing, you've probably noticed, is accelerating and growing in a huge way. Every pub in town, every bar is now a craft pub, you know? Mm. And the problem is that craft beer drinkers, the trend is that you go to a craft pub to drink a new craft beer. So if you're a brewer, a lot of people have jumped on the bandwagon and said, I'm going to make my own craft brewery. So the problem with that is, once you've sold the beer to a bar, they need to buy a different beer the next month or the next 3 months because their customers are looking to try new beers. So with the craft brewery, we looked at that as a problem and tried to figure out what could we do to how can we build a business out of this that's not going to be like the boat sales business where we do the sale once and then we're out and then we don't have this repeat business because it's expensive to do the sales work. So what we did is we worked with we figured out a way to make craft beer really efficiently and get the tastes and the flavors and different beers produced quite really efficiently. Well, I say I did it. I didn't do this, but we talked with Matthias, who basically runs the brewery, did this. And then we worked out a way to come up with different branding for different beers really quickly. And we created basically a three-tiered product out of it. So rather than sort of going and selling our beer, we've created a more of a service business with three different products. So product one is you can buy our beer, which has got our branding on it. Product two is co-branded beer. So you can have our beer with our label, but instead of underneath the name of the beer, you can put your own logo. Or the third version is we can create a beer for you and put your own branding on it. And what that's done is, so we're now going to, we've just got Radisson Blue as a customer. And in some Radisson Blue hotels, we are now creating beers just for that hotel that's all about the city. So they've now got a really unique beer that's about the city that they're in that you can't buy anywhere else. It tastes great. It's a craft beer. People like it because they're getting their craft beer, and it's a hotel because the customer's coming in and out, so they're not drinking it every week. It's a new thing for them. And and now the hotel has got something that it can sort of promote and sell as a reason to come to its bar. And does that make sense? It's a product that's kind of created just for them, but it's actually not because of the way we've done it, because we just put it into a system. So now that's working really well. We've got some other really big hotel chains who are probably the biggest hotel chain in the world that everyone knows about. The deal's not done, so I can't say it, but they should be coming on board soon as well. And we'll be making beers for them, sort of location-based beers, which is, I think it's really cool. And it's just sort of consistent business that's tied in. You just couldn't do that. Normal craft beer breweries just haven't thought that one step ahead. They're just trying to sell to every pub that they meet, and they'll get kicked out after a while because that's what will happen. It just will.
Yeah. Oh, that's really ingenious. I love that. Well, that's a great solution, isn't it? I guess I'm imagining Well, I guess it's true for all of us in all situations. You get in a situation where you can't see the wood from the trees, and we've all got blind spots. And you know, a lot of the time, when you've sort of spent effort, you know, doing your craft, and then from an outside perspective, it's often easier to see like these opportunities and ways of improving it and stuff, isn't it?
That's what I think I do. I mean, I'm always a bit. You might be able to tell I'm a bit sort of wish-washy about it, because when I say it out loud, I always imagine myself sitting around the table with my dad and his mates, or you know, my grandparents or something, explaining that, and they would sort of, I'm just sort of imagining what they would say. So they would say, so what you do is you go in and you talk to people, and you take some of their business and you give them an idea, and then what do you do? And they wouldn't be able to sort of grasp. There's no daily washing of the dishes beyond that point, apart from just making sure that everything is on track. And there is huge value in that, but the challenge is sometimes to it's hard to quantify.
Yeah, because it's kind of an art as well, isn't it? You know, so it's the same as trying to describe any art form, isn't it? It's tricky, isn't it? It's like saying describe how Eric Clapton plays guitar. It's like, well, yeah. you know, it's kind of different every song. It's hard to put into words,
it really is hard. I'm really, I would love to be able to. It's why I know I publish a few posts every now and again, and I used to do a lot of seminars and things like that, but I don't really talk about what I do much outside of the people I work with, because I find it difficult. But my parents and my family think I'm a drug dealer.
Hey, Chris, say that again. It just cut out as you gave the punchline. What was it you said?
I said my friends and my family think I'm a drug dealer.
Oh, right.
And,
okay.
You know, because I just don't talk about it. I just don't know. I don't really. I suppose because I've been a business coach for so long, I've been used to asking questions rather than talking about myself and what we do. And so the only people who really know about it are the partners that we work with. And apart from that, I don't really talk about it. So I don't have clear words for it. Yeah,
that makes sense. You know, at the end of the day, it does take time and effort to constantly explain yourself to everyone, doesn't it? You know, so, you know, maybe. Yeah, I can relate to that.
Can you? Why?
Well, I mean, sometimes with my events, even though I teach handstands, which is a simple description, also they're movement events. So I'll get other teachers in, like dance teachers and yoga teachers. But as well as that, it's kind of an experience as well. Like I'll get someone to do food, and I'll get someone to do a fire pit outside, and I'll have someone doing a gong bath and a sang bath. And it gets to a point where it's hard to describe what it is. It's like, it's not a yoga retreat. It's not a festival. It's not a fitness boot camp. It's not just a workshop. It's like, what is it? I don't know. It's unique and it's brilliant, but it's hard to summarize, you know.
There are loads of people who do the business, like Y Combinator is a huge business incubator. There are some Rocket Internet, the massive internet-based incubator business, and they're very clear. Dent, Daniel Priestley's one. I don't know whether you know Daniel, but they I don't know him, but I've read some of the stuff that that they've been doing about their accelerator program. And it's sort of a combination. What I'm doing is a kind of a mishmash of all those. And the hardest thing for me is kind of what I'm supposed to be doing for the businesses we partner with is make it clear for them to explain exactly what they do. But I've not really found a way to do it for myself. It's like plumber with the leaky tap situation, I think.
I can also relate in a way, like, I mean, it certainly strikes me that you enjoy what you're doing and you get satisfaction out of it and all that kind of thing. And I can relate in a way, because there's hand balancers, like circus hand balancers, that are much, much better than me. I mean, I'm nowhere near as good as them, nowhere close. But I don't care. I don't care what they're doing. I enjoy what I'm doing. I enjoy the way that I target my classes to yoga people. Most of them are beginners, you know, and I'm happy, you know, it suits me. I enjoy it. And I don't care what everyone else is doing. And I kind of get a sense that you sort of feel the same way about your own business. You know, you're enjoying what you're doing. And
yeah, I think so. I think, I battle with this, you know, I can't remember who first said it to me, but They say you should never, it's none of your business what other people think about you. Mm. I battle with that a lot because I really do care about what people think about me. And I want to make sure that I do the right thing for people. And yeah, as a business coach, I struggle with that a lot because I always felt like a bit of a fraud. And I know a lot of the people who we both know and in the circles probably didn't understand how or what I was doing. And, you know, I would say I was a business coach and I was really uncomfortable, even though I did it and I did okay at it. And I was, at the time, it felt like the good thing, the right thing to do. I always felt like a bit of a fake. And since I sort of decided not to be the coach and just be completely straight with where I'm at with people and this is what I will do, this is what I won't do, it just felt a bit easier.
Yeah, I can relate to that. And I think a lot of people experience that same kind of feeling, you know, like we all a little bit feel like we're blagging it sometimes, don't we, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know whether everyone does. I've noticed that in I've noticed since I've been in Germany, I think there's fewer people like that. Or maybe it's just the circles that we sort of came from and spent time in. I don't know. What do you think? Is it I've always looked back on all the things I learned as a bit of a blessing and a curse from the point of view that I got my eyes opened to so many possibilities and committed to this amazing future, and being really young and trying so hard sometimes made me feel quite down and depressed that I hadn't already done it. And all the gurus and people that I was learning from were telling me how easy it was going to be. And maybe they weren't even using those words, but you know what? In my head, that's how I was interpreting it was going to be easy. I was going to do it. And it took, no matter how many times people would tell me it was going to be a hard journey, it was really, really hard. And I'm really grateful that I got to see all those things. But on the other side of it, the thing that I say it's a curse is I know people who are the same age as me who've not been exposed to anything like that, and they seem quite happy. happy not knowing that there's an alternative.
There is an irony with that, isn't there? When you're a very thoughtful person and when you've got a lot of ambitions and you can kind of put a lot of pressure on yourself because you know you want to be successful and you've got such big ideas about what's possible, and the flip side of that coin is it's frustrating if you're not there yet, isn't it? And then the irony that just like the regular person on the street who's just watching the telly or going to the pub, like they're perfectly happy. They don't even care. You know? Like, it's kind of, it's weird like that, isn't it?
Yeah. I'm not saying I'm not happy, you know, but it takes work to remember that. I think that's for me anyway. I have to remember that, I have to remember all the time about how lucky I've been and what we've got now. And yeah, I have to spend a lot of time remembering that. It's hard. That's hard for me.
I've had a rocky road as well. You know, I went bankrupt. Yeah. I think I told you that, did I?
Yeah. Shit. I mean, yeah. What happened? What led to that? What was the sequence of events that led to that?
Well, so I was doing the online guitar lesson thing. So I'll start from the start just for the listeners, cause they might not know. So, when I was a teenager, I was a guitarist and I used to play in bands and I used to teach guitar, and that was fine. And then somewhere along the line, this is when I met you guys. I was watching the TV one night and the Tony Robbins infomercial comes on. And I said to my mum, should we buy the CDs? We'll split the money, you know, go halves. Anyway, long story short, I started going to the networking groups and Yes groups. I met James Richardson and Alex and yourself. And James said, oh, you got to go to UPW. You got to see Tony Robbins. So anyway, fast forward a couple of years. I decided I don't want to exchange my time for money anymore. I don't want to. This is when I first met you, wasn't it? I was doing this, I think.
Yeah, well, I remember the first time I met you, you were still playing in the band and you had a van and in the back of your van was all the music. I think you were like going to a gig or like coming or collect or something like that.
So I started going to the seminars, learning about marketing. And then somewhere along the line, I decided to create online guitar lessons, just video recorded. People download them. And I packed in my guitar. I stopped teaching and it was really successful. It was making good money for a year or two, and then A couple of things went wrong. I found it very difficult to get the music royalties sorted out. There was no simple way of doing it.
What happened? What did people did you get in trouble for it?
I didn't get in trouble. I for a long time I didn't have it sorted out properly. I was just kind of blagging it a little bit. And somewhere along the line, you know, it was worrying me more and more and more. I thought, I got to get the paperwork sorted with all this. Anyway, I started looking into it. I started inquiring with all the relevant intellectual property agencies and stuff. And there was no simple solution. In every region, in every country, there was like a different agency and you had to be registered with all of them. And it was like just an impossible task. And what also the big thing that really got me was... in America, I contacted them and said, you know, what do I have to do? And they said, well, for a start, you can't sell Eric Clapton, Jimi Hendrix, the Beatles, this, that, and that. None of them give permission for any of that. So, and that was like 90% of my catalog. So, now what I, at that point, I probably could have just kept selling them and thought, ah, fuck it, you know, I'll just risk it. And it'd have probably been fine, but it just worried me. It panicked me. I thought, oh no, this is no good. I'm going to get in trouble. I'm going to get sued. You know, I panicked.
But was that just you? Sorry to interrupt, but was that just you or was someone telling you? Were you getting like nudges from people that...
Well, no, it was the music agency themselves sort of explicitly said it right. when I asked them. They didn't threaten me. There was no legal action or nothing. There was no record companies after me, but it just spooked me and I just got panicked and thought, oh no, you know, the consequences. And basically I switched my website off for a bit because it's just stressed me out too much, right? After a little while I kind of calmed back down again and thought, I'll just carry on selling them.
I want some more money.
But
was that it though? Was it really like that? Was it a subscription thing? I can't remember if it was subscriptions or not.
I had both in the end. No, they were just I teach how to play a song, so it'd be like a specific song, and then they just download that for like $10 or something, and then they could buy a package, you know, and then
I watched some of them. I remember watching them. Yeah, I remember watching them.
Yeah, it was good. It was successful. Yeah, I mean, I had millions of views on some of them. You know, it was it was cool. And then so then I'm in a bit of a mess. I sort of, the sales, and also I started getting entangled with Yarl Mo and his offshore tax shelter scheme, which turned out to be a total catastrophe. I wish I'd never done that. That was a big part of the problem. I took terrible advice from Yarl Mo, who I thought was like a tax expert, and he really wasn't. He was just selling this sort of, this structure that this lawyer was providing. It was a really bad decision on my part. I shouldn't have gone down that route. And don't ask me why, but I decided I needed a holiday home in abroad, right? Yarl Mo tells me, yeah, you know, that's fine, buy a holiday home. It'll be like, you know, offshore and, you know, anyway. Zoom forward a little bit. I speak to the actual lawyer who's behind it, the guy who actually knows what he's talking about, and he says, no, you can't do that. You've got to pay tax on all that money. Yarl Mo doesn't know what he's talking about. At this point I'd already put down a deposit. I'd spent about 50 grand or so. I mean, I kicked myself, you know, it's a stupid decision. I'm not blaming, you know, it's my own part I pay as well. But anyway, at this point I've now got a big tax bill that was much bigger than I thought it was going to be. No money, because I've put this deposit down onto this thing and I owe the tax on that money kind of thing. And I'm in a situation where I can't pay my tax bill, and my business kind of the sales were now much less because of, you know, turning the website on and off. And so I was in a situation where I couldn't pay the income tax. The money wasn't coming in, and I was just sort of now between a rock and a hard place. And because of the tax, I ended up going bankrupt. I couldn't pay the bills. So that is what happened.
What's the right word? I wouldn't say enjoy the experience, but as it was happening, were you just accepting it, or were you really, was it causing you stress? Because whenever I see you talk, and I haven't talked to you for 10 years, maybe a few years less than that, but around 10 years, but you always seem chilled out about everything. and not sort of be able to brush it off. So was it, yeah, how was it really? What was really going on?
Yeah, I was stressed during it. Yeah, I was stressed during all that. There was probably a period of, but here's what happened. As a way of coping with it, I kind of just sort of gave up. I kind of let go. And because there was a there was a really stressful point of like needing to pay the bills, having to make the payments, and the money's not coming in, and the money's not there. And then there was like a tipping point where I thought, ah, fuck it, I ain't paying no one, I ain't got it, I'm not going to worry about it. That's that, you know. And then at that point, there's then less stress because you've given up. But then, there's this slow train crash, this slow financial train crash that, and of course, it takes a long time to play out. You know, by the, it takes years and years for the paperwork and the bankruptcy and for it all to play out. And then, so it's a very slow train crash. And yeah, I was pretty much kind of lost for a bit after that. That's when I got into the kind of conspiracy theories about the government. I spent a couple of years on all that, you know, like sort of like, why should we have to do as we're told, all that kind of thing. I'm glad that I didn't waste any more time on that, because it is really unproductive, I think, to spend all your time, you know, trying to figure out who built the pyramids and who's responsible for 9/11 and all that. So I'm only glad I didn't waste more time on that, like a year or two, and I've got it out of my system now. That's done. I'm never doing that again.
But you got, so all of that, I listened to the other podcast that you sent me the link to, the number two one, and I remember you talking a lot about all of the
sovereign citizen. Well,
the sovereign, that's it, sovereign citizen. Yeah, I'm not really, I don't have the language to know enough about it, but I listened to loads of your videos and I learned quite a bit about, I learned a lot from you at that time that was helpful to me in a few other ways. I just wonder, you say I'm glad I got it out of your system, but I wonder, I'm curious to know what you learned about, what you got from it that's useful. Yeah. Because some of it was not you, some of it was clearly BS and, you know, farcical and just made up. But some of it has got some use, hasn't it? I'm sure.
Yeah. And I didn't realize you'd seen it, actually. But yeah, you're right. I suppose the positive that I got out of all that stuff is like really studying the law and constitutional law and kind of understanding how government works. And it's really useful just to consider, you know, like the government gets the power from the people, but then that creates a problem, doesn't it? Because we don't seem to have much influence over it. You know, in theory, we're in control and we vote and we are the decision makers and the people are sovereign. But in actual practice, it doesn't really work like that. You know, we kind of just have to do as we're told and there's not much we can do about it, you know, is the reality. And yeah, it was a long process for me to kind of, I eventually arrived at the realization that the world is not as, that there's a difference between how the world is and how it should be. You know, it's not morally and ethically perfect. You know, we are subject to force and threats by the government, but then it's one of those things where you have to accept what you can and can't control and just put your attention and your effort on the things that you can influence in your life. And thankfully, I eventually arrived at that kind of realization. Like, look, there's no point worrying about what the central bank, you know, the Federal Reserve is doing, or, you know, it's irrelevant to my day to day life. And eventually I started putting my focus on normal everyday life again. Do you know what I mean? Mm.
Can I tell you, I know exactly what you mean. And I want to tell you a story that you won't know because I've never told you about it, but I did learn a lot from you then. I want to tell you how it helped me. What you just said about the being pushed around when I first came to Germany, I was effectively starting afresh. There's another story that the reason we came to Germany was not because I needed a fresh start, but just before we came, there was a business thing that happened and it really knocked me for six and made me sort of start again. that's a separate story. But when I came to Germany, you were sort of doing all of that then. I listened to a few things, and it felt like you were saying to me that you don't have to be bullied by authority. And because somebody sends you a letter that's threatening, that makes you scared from the government or from an organization or from the court, that it feels to most people that because they've got this authority that they are right and you just have to bend over and do what they say. And most people would just go with it. And at the time, I was being taken to court by a company in the UK it's the long story, but the basics of it are they were running an event, but they were asking for speakers. And it was one of these things where they were saying, we've got these amazing speakers, but they were actually charging the people to speak to get a platform to talk to their audience. You know what I mean? Like a business networking event type thing.
Right.
And they asked me to speak, and I said, not sure, when is it? And long story short, I said I would do it, and then I would say I would do it. Send me the details. They sent me the details, and for the first time I learned that there was a fee, and so I wasn't interested. I didn't want to pay a fee to go and speak at their event. I had other things going on. I was busy. Anyway, so the event comes around, and it's a day where I'm actually going on holiday in the afternoon. And the morning of the event, I get a call from the organizer of this event. And she says, are you ready to come today? We haven't heard anything about you. We haven't got a picture. I'm just putting together the slides and to introduce you. What shall I say? And I said, I'm not coming. I didn't commit to coming. You sent me the email with the details. I didn't confirm. And she says, well, I've got you on the list and blah, 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 blah. I couldn't go. So I didn't go to speak at the event. A few months later, this company actually ended up in trouble. But a few months later, I had a letter from the court saying you've been summoned because you owe this company. It was like, I wasn't even much money. It was like 1500 quid or something like that.
What?
Yeah. And in the letter, it says you agreed to speak to this event, and the girl spoke to you on the phone, and you had a verbal contract and blah, 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 blah.
Oh,
and she sent you the contract. So I let it. And what I learned from you was not to be afraid. It's only a tiny thing, but they had all of these. Their evidence was the phone call and the person coming and basically standing in court and saying that we had an agreement against my word. And my defense, there's two stories actually. I'll tell you the second one later, but my defense was I didn't actually agree to it. I didn't send an email back. She says I did, but she sent me the offer, and I, you know, there was no agreement there. Anyway, I didn't have to pay. They had to pay my expenses, and they had to pay quite a lot because I was in Germany. I had to fly back, and it was a waste of their time. But you really taught me that I might have just paid that if you hadn't been doing what you were doing. I thought that's so,
wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. I didn't realize you were listening to my stuff, and that's really nice to hear. That's great to hear something. Because to be honest, most of the time I'm just embarrassed about all that stuff. And, you know, you can probably hear the embarrassment in the way I talk about it all. But that's really nice to hear. And do you know what? I've got some similar situations myself. Like, that is one great thing that came out of it. I learned a lot about how the court process works and the civil procedure. And because really, before you've ever been sued or sued someone, or before you've ever been to court, like, most people have got no idea how the process works. You know, it's just,
yeah,
it's very intimidating, it's very scary, it's very terrifying. You don't know what's going to happen. You know, you've seen kind of things on movies, with lawyers and judges. But one of the great things, even if you go to court just with something silly like a speeding ticket or anything, yeah. And what I used to do, I used to go down to the Crown Court in Bristol and sit and watch the hearings. And I was involved with a few cases myself. You know, it was all minor stuff. It was just stuff to do with the road and speeding and driving a motorbike without a license. You know, it was all kind of petty stuff. But I got familiarized with the process and how it works, you know, and And I've got a couple of similar things at the moment. I'm actually a defendant on one thing, a similar thing to what you've got. There's a marketing company who I was paying to do my Google ads, and they did a shit job. And I had a 12-month contract with them, and I got 9 months in. I was like, fuck this, you know, they're getting bad results, so I just stopped paying them. Anyway, they've sued me for the remaining £300. You know, it's a tiny little thing, but you're right. You know, having gone through all that, I'm familiar with how the court process works. I know it's like a game of poker. They're just blagging and bluffing on the off chance that you fold, and it's just a backwards and forwards game of poker, really. And so and I've got a different situation as well with a girl who I was scheduled to run a handstand workshop at a location. She had seen something on Facebook that I posted that she didn't like, and she emailed the venue and said, you shouldn't let Ben Lowrey run his thing at your venue, he's horrible, he's a sexist, he's a racist. She made up all this stuff. There was no references,
really.
Yeah, it was just accusations, you know. It was just, there was no references. It wasn't like he said this specifically. It was just she decided she didn't like me, and she was going to tell this venue, you know, she had a bee in her bonnet kind of thing. And she wrote this long rambling email to this venue. Anyway, the venue emails me and says, we're sorry, we're gonna have to cancel your event, we've had this. And so I'm doing a claim against her at the moment for the loss of earnings and you know, the defamation. It's currently in process, so I don't know how it's gonna turn out. But yeah, it's the same as what you said. It's like just having that confidence to stick up for yourself and not let yourself be pushed around, and that's a nice feeling. If nothing else, that is something great that came from it.
It's that. So there's two things that I really learned. So that if I had to summarize the two things that I got from listening to you, would be, the first one is I got more confident about backing up my intentions. I know, like, get too deep, but I know in my heart I'm a good person and my intentions are good. I don't believe I've ever gone out of my way to do anyone any injustice. So as long as I'm comfortable with that, then if I make a mistake, then I can put my hands up and kind of deal with it. So that's the first one. So I'm not worried about anything that comes to me, because I know that I've not deliberately tried to do anything wrong. So as long as I'm confident with that. And the second thing is this, I can't explain, you probably explain it better than me. What's this? Can you explain the acceptance, the thing in law about acceptance?
For value.
No, offer. No. Wasn't that?
Offer an acceptance.
Offer an acceptance. Like, that's a big thing. That's the big thing that really helped me, is that all law is an offer and acceptance. Offer and acceptance. And as long as I'm not, the only point it really should. My understanding is, maybe this is wrong, but my understanding is, it should only ever go to court and for someone to sort of mediate a situation when there's a disagreement about a topic, about whether you say I did this and I say I didn't, versus I'm accepting what you say. Well, can you explain it better than I can? Is that
because in essence, especially with business dealings, you know, between, you know, just civil matters, contract law is very simple in essence. You know, someone makes an offer, you accept it, and that's the whole point of writing it down and signing it on paper. So it's easy. So if you do have a disagreement, it's easy to demonstrate that, you know, here's what the terms were. You know, that's the whole point of signing it. And then, like that situation you had, where that sounds like a ridiculous thing they were trying to claim, because it was crazy. I mean, imagine trying to prove a verbal acceptance. You know, that's.
And that wasn't even her point. She just it wasn't as sophisticated as her even saying that. But yeah, go on, because I think it deserves examples, because it's so simple. But I've spoke to people. I heard you talking about a lot about this with credit cards and people getting out of loans or getting into trouble with paying debts and things. And I was sharing some of what you said with a friend of mine, and I didn't think I explained it very well, but it was something like they're asking you for £100, and you're not denying that you owe them £100, but as long as you come back to them with some offer of repayment, they can refuse it and you can go back to them and it can go around as long as you don't say, I'm not going to pay you. Isn't that is there something in that, or is that too?
I don't think so. I think, I think the important principle is you can ask for the proof that that you owe it to them. I guess, but I think you can perhaps send up just kind of, what am I trying to say? I think in a city, but this is probably how my attitude has changed over time. I think if you did agree to pay it back to them, then it's as simple as that, really. That's kind of my attitude now, you know.
Yeah.
Whereas at the time I was a bit more, what's the word?
No, I don't think I got from it that you don't pay it back. I think that's the thing that maybe I probably paused or rolled my eyes and thought, this is crazy. I think the thing that I learned was that if I owe you £100 and you say I need it today, and I say, I can't give you £100, Ben, but I can give you £1. And then you can come back to me and say, no, that's not acceptable. I want 100. And I can come back to you and say, no, I can give you 2. That cycle, you know, as long as I'm not saying I'm not going to pay you back, that's kind of difficult for anyone to. I mean, what can anyone do to you? Is that right?
No, I don't think so. No, they could. Okay. I think if they wanted to, they could go and do a claim at the court and they could say, look, he's just wasting our time messing us around. And
And even then, but even in that situation, if I turned up to the court, I've never been in this situation, so it's difficult for me to say. But what I think I would be confident to. I'm not going there. To sort of try to get out of paying you, but I'm going there with my arms open, saying I'm doing my best to do it. At least, isn't there some sort of rule that says they have to look at the situation and take what they can from you? Or I don't know what happened.
I think it's very that's what the judge is there for. It would be down to the judge's discretion. If he's not convinced that you're if he thinks you're playing games and doing stalling tactics, that's essentially what the judge is there for. And if he's not convinced, then he'll order in the other person's favor. So no, I don't think that kind of thing would fly.
I think what I learned from it then is I don't think I'm saying it to sort of try and get out of paying somebody. I think what I mean is that it just gives people confidence to go into a situation like that and get a fair outcome. You know, if the judge is there to try and get a fair outcome, then and you're walking in with saying, I'm not saying I can't pay you your £100, but this is my situation.
Oh, yeah.
Do your worst to me. Not being sort of fearful that.
Totally. Yeah, I think I see what you mean now. Yeah, like it's like I had a situation. I had a couple of speeding tickets, right. And for whatever reason, I end up in the court. Like, I didn't pay them or whatever. Because if you pay them, you don't have to go to the hearing. But anyway, I'm in the court. And the public prosecutor on the government side, he says, you know, Mr. Lowrey owes this much, and then we're entitled, you know, you've got to.
This is when you thought you knew better than the court.
Yeah. Well, in this example, they said, you know, he has to pay this penalty and that penalty and da-da-da, and the total is like 600 quid or whatever. And I said to the magistrates, there's three of them, I said, I can't afford that. He's asked for too much. That's not fair. I'll pay half of that. And they said, yeah, we agree. That was a bit excessive. So, yeah, we'll order you to pay half of that. So, yeah, I think what you're trying to say is, yeah, you got to stick up for yourself. You got to kind of fight your own corner, haven't you? And not let people take advantage of you and bully you.
Yeah, exactly. And not sort of exactly. That's what I think I really learned from it, is that just because some authority is saying this, as long as I'm not. The problem, I think, maybe I felt like the friend I'm talking about, I think you actually know him, but that's an aside. The friend I'm talking about was trying to get out of paying his debts, you know, trying to find. And I was talking about this, and he was excited. I remember having the conversation. This was a long time ago. This is probably just when you were doing it. And I was saying, watch Ben's stuff. It's really interesting. And I think what he got from it was, I can get out of paying my debts. And I don't think I ever got that to that point where I thought that was possible. But what I did learn was that it's okay to not. The way you present yourself in a courtroom against an accusation like that is not to try to get out of it and win the case, but it's just to say, I've made a mistake, and you know, you're right, and I will pay you if that's true, but this is the situation I'm in, and sort of get a fair result, you know.
Yeah, rather than just rolling over and being a doormat kind of thing.
Yeah, or trying to go, not rolling over, but trying to be so aggressive that you end up getting a worst, getting a sentence or getting a judgment that means that you are in a situation that you can't deal with, and you know.
Oh yeah, that can happen, because if you've got a bad attitude, they can give you like the maximum sort of penalty. Some of the gurus that I was learning from, they're all in prison. You might have heard me say that on that other conversation.
I did, yeah.
There was one really recently, a couple of weeks ago, he got sentenced, and he was one of the guys that was peddling a lot of the tax protest, the tax avoidance theories, and it eventually caught up with him, and he was obstructive, and he didn't cooperate at all the way he could, and they gave him pretty much the maximum sentence they could. They gave him 10 years for it, because it was huge numbers, you know. He'd been doing it for years, he hadn't been paying tax for years, and it had finally all caught up with him. He got 10 years. There was another guru really similar, he was teaching this stuff, and they were triggering tax refunds fraudulently, basically, from the government. They were filling out the paperwork in such a way that it would trigger a tax refund, and that it was large sums, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, you know, cumulatively. There was a group of people that did millions, and they all got put away. One of them got 20 years, you know, and it just goes on and on and on.
So I think they should as well. Like, you don't get. They're trying to. I think it's like a deliberate scam, you know. Yeah. And this is what I think I learned, is if my intentions are good. And if I earn some money, I want to keep it. And if it's mine, I made a mistake. Or if I've made a mistake in a contract, then fair enough, I'll sort it out. But I don't want to be bullied with it. But that crossed the line.
I completely agree. That is great. I completely agree. I get what you're saying. Just feeling empowered to stick up for yourself is a really great thing. Yeah, regardless if it's like, you know, government and courts and laws or whatever it is, just agree.
It's helped me a lot.
There was another question I wanted to ask you with regards to you're married, right?
We got married 2 years ago, so we've been together for 15 years. Janina, do you remember Janina? She said, say hi.
I did meet her when you were in Bath one time.
Yeah. She said, say hi.
Oh, cool.
Hi, Ben. Hi. So, yeah. So carry on.
No, I was wondering, I'm interested.
Actually, sorry, Ben, but before you ask the question, can I please pause, leave the recording going? Can I please pause to go for a wee?
I'm
going to
do the same. I'll race you back. Cool. Okay.
Right. See you then. That's it. You beat me. I got a beer as well, so.
I was going to say, either I'm quicker at weeing than you, or your toilet is closer or further away than mine is. We'll never know. So what I was going to ask, I have not figured out is what is the right kind of woman to go for me. And I was wondering, because I see Grant Cardone and I see his wife, and they both do their business stuff together, and I can see that she's fully into the whole entrepreneurial lifestyle, and she's supportive, and and I've been trying to figure out, you know, I've been going for the wrong kind of women. I've been like, for the last 5 years, I've been going for yoga girls, and and recently I've realized that might be a mistake, because a lot of the time they're quite anti-capitalist. Obviously not always, I'm talking in generalizations, but
I thought they'd be quite flexible.
It has not worked for me, you know, like the circus world and the arts world and being around dance classes and yoga. It's all very liberal, very left wing, very often anti-capitalist. And really, I've recently realized I've been in completely the wrong environment, because I'm a business person like you are. I'm excited by business, I'm excited by money, and I feel like I've just been around the wrong people. And I wanted to ask you, is your partner or your wife supportive, you know, is she involved with what you do, like how does that work?
Okay, so I mean, we've been together now for 15 years, so I was with Yanina before I met you even. So we've got three kids now.
Wow.
So a lot's changed for us since we got to Germany. I don't know why I'm saying that. That's not really relevant. What are you asking? Why is she involved? Before I answer the question, what makes you think that that's important?
Well, I'm not really sure. I mean, I'm trying to figure out what kind of woman I need to be with, and I'm just curious if, like, other entrepreneurs such as yourself, like, do you think it's important to be with a partner who's, like, I don't know, at least supportive or enthusiastic about what you do? I'm not really sure what I'm asking.
Mm-hmm. I've thought a lot about this. So before Yanina and I got together, I'm, like, as you know, very ambitious and probably two steps ahead. What I say and how I behave is probably two steps ahead of where I'm actually at. And when I met Yanina, that was interesting to her because she'd never experienced anything like that. And it was kind of, oh, this is interesting. And she tells me that she thought I was already a millionaire when I met her. and not because I said those words, but because of maybe some of the other things I sort of surrounded it with. And when she realized where I was at, I think it was probably interesting to her. And I think since then she's been a little bit involved in some stuff and then completely out of it, and then a little bit involved and then completely out of it. Recently she's been working in the business and doing some stuff, because I say working, she's been helping out with a few things. There's a book, what's it, The Millionaire Mindset or The Millionaire Mind, there's a book, I can't remember which one it is. It's probably on my shelf over there, I could go and have a look. But they did the book is about studying, I think it's like 100 millionaires, not super successful, rich list people, but just people who've got a few million in the bank and are very comfortable. And the top profession of the spouse was a teacher.
Ah.
And that, I thought that was interesting because Yanina's a teacher by training as well, but that's not why I thought it was interesting. But I just made me think, I don't know whether it's 100% necessary, because people want their partners. When you're sort of starting out, we were very lucky. We've been together for 15 years. We met and she was very committed and confident in what she was going to do, and I was as well. And I think what was more important is we just let each other do our own thing and accept that she's a whole person, I'm a whole person, and if we agreed on everything and if we saw eye to eye on everything, then what's the point in having a partner? Like, half the point of it is to have some balance, I think. And if we were both exactly the same, I may as well be by myself.
Yes, that makes sense. Yes.
So when people are looking for the right person, I always think my first question or thought is, like, if you're looking for someone exactly the same as you, with exactly the same thoughts and wants exactly this. I think okay, so the thing that me and Yanina have in common is the destination. Like, we both, when I was really sort of getting started and we both met, I was really sort of being exposed to this world of what was possible and wanting to buy an island and a plane and all those things that we both sort of thought were a really nice thing to sort of aim for in life. And we both still want to have a great life and live, you know, we live a really nice life, and we both love that part of it. So that's the one thing we have in common, but I don't think it matters that we are both, like, I don't expect her to go and start a business. If that makes sense. As long as we both sort of, I'm happy that she's doing what she's doing. There's stuff that she does for me that I could never do. Like, and don't just mean physical things, but just emotionally and all those sorts of things. So I don't know how to answer your question. So I don't think it is important. I know people say, I heard the other guy you asked that question to said, yeah, it's really important. My wife is, you know, and we're both, I'm not sure. I don't know. I don't think for me, it's not true. I'm happy that she likes other things and her music, you know, she likes shit music and shit TV. And I can't sit in the room with her while she's watching whatever she's watching. And that's fine. She's not interested in what I do and that stuff. And that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah. I can get, that's interesting for me to hear you say that. Yeah. So I'm trying to figure that out for myself. Who knows? That makes sense. I like the answer.
You just have to like someone. You just have to think that you know. You have to accept, like, we fight. We're in the office the other day, shouting at each other, really shouting. But for us, when we're shouting at each other and arguing, you know, there's no question in my mind. I hope in hers. I'm sure in hers as well that this is going to cause a problem in our relationship. It's just that that's part of it, you know, that we disagree on stuff and we see things differently. I think I've had to learn that try to chill out a bit and not worry about that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that's quite a big topic, isn't it, to open up the whole sort of relationship thing. That's a whole conversation in itself, isn't it, really, that could... So, I appreciate you... sharing that with us. I think if it's okay, we'll wrap up pretty soon, but there is a couple of things. Are you all right for another kind of 10 minutes or something?
I'm all right for as long as you want. Honestly, the children are now in bed. I've got a beer. We can talk for as long as you want, and I've enjoyed it.
Loving it. And actually, I would keep going. There's I did make an appointment to speak to someone else, but it's flexible, so it doesn't matter. But what I was going to say is, who do you follow? Who's the people you enjoy reading or watching or following?
Tell you what I do. I get my phone. I'm a big Audible fan and podcast fan. And I'm going to open up my app. Trust. What's this saying? That's asking me for that. So my podcast, I've got Gary V, or probably the same people as you do, Gary Vaynerchuk, Noah Kagan. Do you know him?
No, I don't.
He's the guy who runs Sumo, App Sumo. Okay. Tim Ferriss. I think I remember you saw a poster from you saying you hate him.
I can't stand that guy. Fucking voice.
I tell you what, I like, I love the detail that he goes into, but sometimes the questions are so convoluted that I get lost before
keep going.
Okay, so I've got Reid Hoffman, Tribe of Mentors. That's brilliant, so you should definitely check that one out. He's the guy who runs who set up LinkedIn and runs an investment company now, and was part of PayPal, but he's really interesting. He's interviewing some really good people. Who else? That's my friend Ben, different Ben. That's I've deleted a bunch of those podcasts. The Digital Marketer podcast is quite good. I mean tons of stuff. I'm constantly listening to stuff. The book I'm reading at the moment, or just listening to, is called Radical Candor. That's worth a listen to. It's about how to learn to say exactly what you mean. As I'm building more people, as more people come into the team, and I'm surrounded by more people who need attention and need to be looked after, I find that really useful to sort of say what needs to be said without upsetting anyone, but still getting the message across clearly. Like, you know, if someone's done an okay job at work or a shit job at their work, to be able to explain that their work is shit, but not offend them personally. So that's quite cool. I could go it depends. Ask me some detailed questions. I think that's what would be cool. Like, I feel like we've had a nice chat and catch up. If we're going to talk about something, what should we should find something that people might find interesting.
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to do that. Definitely some of those podcast names I'd not heard before. I do follow Gary Vee, but I will check out the other ones you mentioned. So that was helpful. Nothing jumps to mind. So is there something you were thinking?
No, not really. What are you going to do next? You said, I'm not sure what I'm going to do next. And a lot of people say that. So how are you going about figuring it out? Because it's a hard thing to do. Like, if you're saying I'm going to start from the beginning with a blank sheet, like, what are your rules? That'll be, interested to know what you're going to do.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Well, I do have a fairly clear idea of the direction I want to go in. I'm happy with things I've been doing. You know, the handstand workshops are great. I earn money doing that and it's fun, and I'm happy to carry on doing that. Recently I began a new project, which was a goal setting and networking event, and I ran the first one recently and it went really well. The format was really simple and I think it was quite unique. It was sort of different than I think anything else. What I did, I put questions out to the group and they had to answer the questions, and it was quite open questions about life, you know, memories from the past, you know, think of a time when XYZ happened, and I got them to sort of write down their answers and then get into pairs and share the answers with each other, and I kept making people change around so everyone got a chance to meet everyone. So it was a goal setting and networking event, and the great thing I love about that is I see that as sort of scalable. I think that could be
Can I jump in and ask you a question then? Rather than talk about how, I'm interested to know what the end game is and your thoughts on goals, because I've thought a lot about goal setting and the times I've done a lot of planning and goal setting. I've taught it and I've coached people through it. So what's your, how do you see all of that as useful right now? And what role does it play in choosing what you do?
Do you mean like what's my sort of longer term vision for what I want for myself? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, you could probably answer it for yourself, but also just the goal. How do you feel about setting goals and how do you go about it? Because I'm interested to know how other people
Okay, so I'm very feeling based. I really care about whether how ideas feel, if they feel exciting, if they don't. I'm not at all specific about, I'm not one of these people who does like, what's that thing where it's like a goal has to be specific and measurable, mm-hmm. and
smart goals. Yeah.
For me, I'm not into that. The only thing I measure anything by is how exciting it feels and how good it feels and if it makes me feel good. And that can change 1 minute to the next, 1 day to the next. So for me, my inner compass is whatever feels good. Right.
Can I have an example?
Yeah, I'll give you an example. Like some people with training and fitness, they're very regimented and they believe they should stick to a fixed schedule and they should train, you know, to a certain target. And I don't like doing that. I train like if I don't feel like I want to go to the gym, for me there's no concept of discipline at all. Like if I don't feel like I want to do it, I don't do it, because I believe there's like my body knows better, or there's like a like your body's got a higher knowing or something, or like an inner wisdom. Like it, perhaps if you don't want to, if you don't feel like you want to exercise, it's probably because your body needs to rest and rejuvenate or something like that. That's the way I see it. Whereas other people might force themselves. It's like, no, I got to be disciplined. I've got to go to the gym. I need to do these number of reps. And so it's like a completely different way of looking at it, if that makes sense. And you know.
Yeah, I think what I was just listening to someone talking about this the other day, and that's why I'm interested to know what people mean by goals, because I don't know what my interpretation of a goal, like I don't know whether it matches everybody else's, but like you just said, so someone might, so you're talking about someone maybe saying, I want to get a six pack, and that's my goal. And I'm writing down a set routine of what I need to eat and what exercises I need to do, and they'll force themselves to follow that plan until they've done it, come hell or high water. And yeah, typically I either meet people who do that and are miserable, or they do it and then they fail because it's so hard that they get tempted by something that's not easy and fail, and they, you know, they see a packet of biscuits and eat the whole fucking packet of biscuits because they've had one bite and then fuck it, the plan's gone to shit, I'm gonna fail, and they give up. So those kind of goals, yeah, they don't, I always find they don't work, and I hear a lot of people talking about them, but I don't, yeah, I'm with you, I don't like.
I agree what you mean. And the only reason I think I choose the word goal to describe the workshop is it's almost like it's like the simplest way of describing it. But I think really what it is, it's more like a honing in on feelings workshop, really. But yeah, I just kind of call it goal setting because that's just the easiest way to describe it. And also another thing that I really feel is true, I think you need one singular vision for what you want, like in the long term, and have that as one thing that everything else is working towards. I don't see the point of having like interim steps and interim goals, like
It's not, yeah, I that's exactly, I've got on my board. It's not a goal, it's like a destination, or not even a destination. It's my next destination, that's what I call it. It's like, there's no time frame to it, but I've got a picture on my wall. I can't see it now, it's in the other room, and it's of a lake with my plane. I've got this, and there's a couple of, I've thought about it a lot. I know why I want a tiny little plane, and I don't have a goal that I've sat down and thought, right, I need to do this today, this tomorrow, this is what's happening next year. It's not that detailed, but I use it as more of like a sort of a set of rules or a guiding light, if that makes sense. So if I'm making a decision about what I'm doing today, is it heading that direction, or is it not? You know, does it get me that does that make sense? Is,
Yeah, totally. It does make sense. Yeah, I think we're on the same page with that. Yeah, I lean much more towards the intuitive kind of, yeah, like not overthinking and over planning it all too much. You know, because there's a lot of moving parts and a lot of variables in there with life. You know, like you can set a goal one minute and then you might feel differently the next day. You know, I like to be a bit lucid and a bit flexible and stuff. And yeah, I mean, you know, I'm sure people have got different views on that of what's the right and the wrong way to live life. But yeah, I think that works for me. Yeah, that way of approaching it.
What do you call it then? Like, how do you describe, like, your version of what I said? This little plane on the lake for me is represents a lot of stuff. It doesn't, it's not about the plane, but I use it to represent like for me, it's like this picture of what I'm working on. Have you got, what,
Yeah,
What
I
does
do.
that look like for you?
It looks like we're at the Northern Lights. There's I'm arriving by helicopter. There's a huge event, there's going to be a huge circus show or something, or some huge event that like is my event. I don't know what it is. Like maybe it's a UPW kind of thing or something. And and that's my vision. The helicopter's landing almost in a kind of presidential kind of way, you know, like and that's my vision that excites me. Yeah, it is.
That's what I like. Like, I think people don't talk about that often enough. I don't have people that I talk to about this very often, and I don't think people remember that often enough because, like, how you get there. This is why my family think I'm a drug dealer, I think, because whenever they ask me, what are you doing? It's always a slightly different story, or what the project I'm involved with is always changing, and they can't quite understand what I do. But I always think it doesn't really matter what I'm doing right now, because I know where I know where I'm heading, and I feel like I'm going in the right direction. And I think, I don't talk about it enough with people. I don't really know people who like talking about that sort of thing enough. I don't know what it is about it that frightens people, maybe. I don't know.
I love that topic. I tell you who had a massive impact on me in this on this topic was Abraham Hicks. Are you familiar?
I've got an Abraham Hicks recording, I think on Audible or somewhere, and the voice of the recording put me off so much. I couldn't get over. It was so I couldn't. Is that the same? Is that am I talking about the same person?
Yes, a woman. Her name's Esther. So what happened for me was I went into it for years. She was on The Secret, right? I can't remember where that came out. Was it like 2006 or something? I went into it, and then she came to Bristol on a tour, and I went with my parents, and there was a couple of people I knew there. It didn't really resonate with me, right? Years and years later, I think it was around about 2013, 2014. I don't know why, but some reason I started listening to her on YouTube, and suddenly it clicked. It really clicked what she was saying, and I really got it for the first time. And that had a huge impact on me. And it's re her the Abraham stuff has,
So
been
when
a
it
big
clicked,
part.
what was it that clicked? What was the realization?
Well, what clicked was it's all about how you feel. You're creating the feel like the if you. Yeah, that's essentially it. It's all about how you feel. You're generating the feeling, and the full manifestation of all the stuff you think you want cannot feel better than that feeling. And she calls it the vortex, right? The language is a bit, it perhaps puts people off because it's a bit new agey and a bit cosmicky. But she calls it being in the vortex, which is basically all that means is being in the best mood, where you feel great, where you feel resourceful, where ideas come easily, where you feel certain, where you're not worried about anything, where things flow. She calls that being in the vortex, right? And so her thing is like all you need to do is get into the vortex. There's nothing more important than getting into the vortex. Think about whatever you got to think about, do whatever you got to do, go wherever you got to be, anything. What just get in the vortex, and then all the answers, all the creativity, all the solutions, will come easily from that state of being. So.
I get it. I think I get it. I think I can relate to it. How do people do it though? I can't remember. I can't remember where I can't remember the moment where I thought sort of realized that that was the thing to focus on and not how many sales I had made this month. Does that make sense? Like there's I've definitely sort of relaxed around the details of how what I'm doing today and worrying about those and just sort of accepted that generally the path that I'm on is good and it's going in the right direction. Like what do
Well,
you
it's
do
like
some like I know I've heard you talk about like sitting down and doing it every morning and things. Do you is that necessary? Because I don't do that. I don't sit there and meditate every morning on it and things, but I just feel like it's working at the moment. Does
yeah,
that
that's
make
yeah, that's right. I mean, if it's working for you, it's going to be different for everyone, you know, like if it if it, it you know, I think you should follow whatever feels right. If it doesn't feel appealing or necessary to sit and, you know, write a list of goals, then don't do it. You know, if it feels more appealing to go walk the dog or something, do that. You know, that I think that's the guiding principle. Whatever feels mm-hmm. good is going to be the path of least resistance. I think that, I like it.
That's really useful. Like that, to there's so many prescriptive gurus out there that say, do this, sit down every 10 minutes, do this. What's the miracle morning is the latest one, or the one I heard most recently people talking about and getting excited about. Have you seen that one?
No, I haven't.
Really popular. Loads of people I know are following it, but it's very prescriptive. This is what you need to wake up at this time. You need to do this exercise.
I thought that. Breathe.
You know, exactly. Yeah.
I tell you what, Chris, how do you feel about perhaps doing a part two at some point in the future? I think I'm going to have to get off Skype because I told somebody else I was going to speak to them. But I'm really enjoying the conversation. So please don't think I wanted to stop talking. It's just because of this other guy. But I tell you what, I'm going to be moving over to Wales and speaking to Alex and getting involved with the property stuff soon. So maybe we could like check back in with each other in a few months and sort of catch up with the latest.
Yeah, let's do it. And maybe I'm over into Newport after New Year for a day. I'll definitely catch up with Alex because have you met her new husband yet?
Yes, he's great.
I introduced them, so
she told me that.
I've known him for much longer, since he was a kid. Let's do that. Yeah, cool.
Great. Just before we go, just tell people if they want to find you, you know, what's the website to go to?
I've got chrisgibbons.net. There's nothing on there, a few links, but if you need to catch up with me, just go there and you'll find me.
Thanks, Chris. I've really enjoyed talking. I'm really sorry to cut it off as well, but we'll speak again soon.
Yeah, good. Cheers, mate.
Thanks for your time. Bye-bye.
Bye now. Bye.